And welcome to The One Show, live from Buckingham Palace with Alex Jones.
And Matt Baker. Now, we're in these gorgeous surroundings by royal invitation to help launch a very special concert to mark the Queen's Diamond Jubilee.
Yes, and tonight's guest is fit for royalty, as he's been given the honour of choosing the artists who are going to perform. And as you can hear, he's tinkling the ivories in the music room as we speak. It is, of course, Gary Barlow!
Gary, well, thanks for joining us in these rather posher surroundings to usual.
Do you know why I was playing that?
Go on.
It's actually one of the Queen's favourite songs.
And more.
I don't just randomly play that number.
Yeah. But, you know, it was wonderful, because just before we came on air, Gary was entertaining our little audience here. This has to be one of the grandest places that you've ever played.
It's beautiful, but it's what I'm used to.
Yes. Well,
and as Matt said, you've got the responsibility of being chief booker for the biggest concert. That's happening right outside the palace, of course. Are you feeling the pressure?
Now you mentioned it, I am, definitely.
You'll be all right.
We'll be all right.
Yeah, don't worry about it, I think. Now, shortly, Gary will be giving us all the details on how you can enter a ballot for tickets to this spectacular concert to mark the Queen's Diamond Jubilee in June.
Yes, as I said, it'll be taking place outside Her Majesty's front door with the likes of Tom Jones, Elton John and Paul McCartney.
Yes, and here is the thing, because everybody has the same chance of getting an invite, as tickets are not on a first-come, first-served basis.
Yes, also coming up, the moment we took to the floor to perform a dance together right here in the palace.
Can you believe it? We've dusted down our dancing shoes.
Yep.
And,
what a debut.
Indeed. You can see what happens a little bit later. But first, Dan Snow has been finding out how major royal celebrations have changed over the years.
We're pretty good at pageantry. In fact, the British do a big royal event better than anybody.
Concord coming in with the red arrows.
So you'd imagine that monarchy and ceremony have marched in perfect harmony throughout history. But the relationship between pomp and the palace is more checkered than you might think. Certainly in the 16th and 17th centuries, monarchs like Henry VIII and Charles II revelled in public displays of grandeur.
By the mid-19th century, the pageantry had been getting less and less frequent, and quite frankly, we were terrible at it. One aristocratic observer watched Queen Victoria open Parliament in 1860. He was extremely unimpressed. He wrote, "Some nations have a gift for ceremonial. In England, the case is exactly the reverse."
Queen Victoria hated royal magnificence and shunned public appearances. But within 40 years, the British had rediscovered their gift for pageantry, culminating in Victoria's spectacular Diamond Jubilee. So what changed and why? Alistair Bruce is an expert on royal ceremonies.
There was a need in the middle of the 19th century to make the crown much more available to the public's understanding. So Queen Victoria, having hidden away after her husband died, was persuaded to use history and pageantry to put herself back onto the stage. And they opened up the dressing up box. They brought out all the traditions of Britain and covered it with gold, purple and red. And through the great events like the Golden and then the Diamond Jubilee, Queen Victoria becomes the obvious and visual personification of the great monarchy at the centre of this enormous empire.
Queen Victoria's Jubilee celebrations were the beginning of a new age. Royal traditions were reinstated and reinvented as the British once again celebrated their monarchy in extravagant style.
This magnificent gold state coach is around 250 years old, but for most of Victoria's reign, didn't actually see much use. She found it too distressing to ride in it. But at the beginning of the 20th century, it was taken out and dusted off and was used more often in state and royal occasions. This really symbolises Britain's growing reputation for pomp and pageantry.
That was cemented by a new tradition, the grand ceremonial of a royal wedding. They used to be private affairs, but in 1922, when Princess Mary got married, George V made it a public event by staging it in Westminster Abbey. So royal ceremony isn't set in stone. It evolves to suit changing times, a process that has continued during the current Queen's reign. Peter Whittle has studied how royal celebrations like Jubilees have been transformed.
they are still in essence the same. We still have carriages and we still have balcony appearances, but there are subtle alterations here and there. So if you look at the Silver Jubilee in 1977, there were a huge number of carriages, right down to the most minor members of the royal families, which is very Victorian. But by the time we got to the Golden Jubilee, the more minor members of the royal family all went in a kind of big minibus. In the past two decades, there's been more emphasis put on the Queen and her immediate family. And it's not so good necessarily to have a huge extended family on display.
The Golden Jubilee was a far less aristocratic occasion than previous royal celebrations and included a parade that was about the people rather than simply for them.
We had bikers, people from the Notting Hill Carnival, we had floats representing each decade of the Queen's reign. So it was much more of a kind of festival, and it worked very, very well. And I think that the way in which it was presented, with these pop concerts, which were extremely new, and with this parade, really showed that the monarchy was trying to evolve in the way it presented itself.
Of course, last year there was another huge occasion, the royal wedding, and that could boost the Diamond Jubilee celebrations.
If there are long periods between these events, essentially people forget what has to happen. This time, because we had the royal wedding last year, it acted as a kind of curtain raiser for the Diamond Jubilee, so people now know really how they can celebrate. So I think we're going to see possibly the biggest royal occasion for 60 years.
So be prepared for the Diamond Jubilee to be a huge celebration of a remarkable 60-year reign. It will stretch from one end of the land to the other. It will be spectacular. It will certainly be a party fit for a queen.
Well, there you are. Brian May was definitely the standout moment from the Golden Jubilee.
Yeah.
You're integral, Gary, to organising the Diamond Jubilee. How will you top it?
They're going to have to fly me in, me or Russell Grant.
High wire. Yeah,
that's great. On a piano, just coming
yeah,
down as you go.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Fantastic. Now, obviously, Dan, I mean, this is a hugely important week, but this is a very special day, isn't it? Because it's 60 years to this very day when the Queen arrived on the plane back from Africa.
This is the first time she arrived in Britain as Queen 60 years ago today. We've actually got some footage here, her landing at Heathrow, and it's just the most amazing thing about this is she gets greeted by, there he is on the right, Winston Churchill, her first Prime Minister. And since him, he's the first of 12 prime ministers that she's worked with and granted an audience to. I mean, it's a huge span of history. Mm.
And we have to remember, of course, that was a sad day for the Queen because she just found out that her father died the night before, hadn't she?
Absolutely, wearing black, exactly. Mm.
Yeah. Now, here we are in the music room, which, like the palace, all the palace is steeped in history. Why is this room then so sort of monumental?
Well, it's the music room. It's got great acoustics. You can hear each other very well. But it's got this gorgeous, for me, it's sort of like Aladdin's cave, really. As a historian, it's so exciting. We're sitting here, Gary. This is 1790. The French Revolution was raging.
I can tell. I've got to be honest.
Yeah.
Can you?
Yeah. It needs new stuff.
Feels old.
We were saying during that film, actually, see, it is quite difficult to work out what position we should be sort of sitting
because
in.
Because if you sit back, you see, you can't touch the floor.
Yeah, yeah. No, well, you can't, no. But, I mean, lots of christenings happened in
lots
this
of christenings,
very room.
And also, very interestingly, the chapel of Buckingham Palace was destroyed during the Blitz by German bombing. Yeah. They had nowhere for christening, so Prince Charles came along and they christened him in this room. In fact, here's some pictures. He's sitting on his mother, who was then Princess Elizabeth's lap. There's little Prince Charles. Mm. And that began a tradition, and Prince Andrew, Princess Anne, and then Prince William, the Duke of Cambridge, he was also christened in here, using water from the River Jordan. So it's a very special room for the family. And, of course, it's this room as well, that famous picture of the Queen with Barack Obama and Michelle Obama was taken in last year. And you just think, wow, from Winston Churchill to Barack Obama, that's been what she, you know, her reign. I mean, that is incredible.
But there's over 700 rooms in this palace, and every single one is just steeped in history.
Over 50 guest bedrooms. You play your cards right, you might get a room tonight. But 19 reception rooms, and this is one of them, obviously. But and it's just all of the rooms are appointed with all these incredible furniture and paintings.
Yeah, good stuff. Thanks, Dan. Keep looking.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Well, the biggest event at the palace this year is, of course, going to be the Diamond Jubilee concert. Now, Gary, as we've said, is one of the chief party planners for the historic event.
We keep planning the full time.
And you at home have a chance to go to this concert.
Yes, here's Anita Rani with all the information that you'll need.
It's going to be the concert of a generation. An exclusive ticket for an evening with some of the world's biggest artists.
The Diamond Jubilee concert will be taking place on the 4th of June, right here in front of the Queen Victoria Memorial at Buckingham Palace. It's going to be the centrepiece of the celebrations. And when I say it's going to be huge, I mean it's going to be massive.
The event has an amazing lineup. The ones I can tell you about: Tom Jones, Shirley Bassey, JLS, and Elton John, to name a few.
It's going to be a wonderful show. There's so many great artists on it, and it runs the gamut of British musical history. I've never performed outside of Buckingham Palace. I've been inside, but I've never performed. So it's going to be fun. It's an extremely important historic event. So I was extremely honoured to be asked.
It's not just Gary Barlow who Her Majesty the Queen has appointed to curate the concert. There's another familiar name in charge, Robbie Williams. No, not that Robbie Williams. But after working with many of music's biggest names and staging huge events, from Nelson Mandela's 90th birthday concert to the Queen's Golden Jubilee, this man certainly knows how to entertain you.
There are 10,000 tickets being given away. Where will they all be seated?
We'll be moving all the plants from the flower beds over there and building very large seating stands for the audience. And there will be 5,000 in each of those seating bleachers.
So they really are hot tickets. They're the ones
you want. They should be fantastic. Hopefully one of the finest concerts that's ever been staged.
Are you excited?
Oh, yes. It's not often that you get to put on a concert in front of Buckingham Palace. I always love doing something that's a challenge, and there's no doubt about it. This is certainly a challenge.
Here's the really important bit. There's going to be a ballot of 5,000 pairs of tickets, and each ticket holder will be able to nominate a guest. But how do you get your hands on them?
Everyone's got a fair chance. Tickets will be randomly drawn after the closing date in a way that reflects population spread across the UK, so tickets are not first come, first served.
You can enter the ballot online at www.bbc.co.uk/Diamond Jubilee.
Or you can apply by post by sending a postcard with your name, address and contact number to the address below.
To apply, you must be 18 or over as of today.
The applicant needs to have a residential address in the UK.
You can also apply if you have a British Forces post office address.
Remember, there's no rush. There is as much chance of being selected whether the application is received today or on 2nd of March.
The Queen's Diamond Jubilee is going to be the nation's celebration, and the concert will be a once-in-a-lifetime experience. So whether you're lucky enough to have a ticket and be right here or partying along at home, it's going to be a right royal knees-up.
Indeed it is. Now, Gary, you've planned big concerts before, maybe not on this scale, but what's your process? What do? Do you ring up all the artists individually? Or?
I was asked to do this about 6 months ago, and one of the first things I wanted to do was change the look of the whole stage, and that's why it was in the back garden, which is just here last time.
All right.
And by moving it to the front, I think it's going to make it a whole new experience for everybody, to open it out to the whole public.
Looks amazing.
We're hoping to have about 500,000 people there. So it's going to be a massive concert.
Yeah. Now, you did a press conference, of course, this morning. We heard some names that are on the bill. Mm-hmm. But from the horse's mouth, give us a rundown. Go on.
Oh, now you're testing me.
Yeah.
one of the most exciting artists I'm excited about is Elton John. He's always been a big hero of mine, so to be able to book him for this was incredible.
Yeah.
So Paul McCartney, Tom Jones, JLS, Dame Shirley Bassey. I mean, we're in for a great event. Jesse J.
Yeah. And do you actually contact them personally? Do you ring them up?
Do you know what? In the past, I've done these kind of shows before, and I've always found that the personal approach is always the best. To speak to them, to tell them what it's about, to tell them what you're trying to do, that's the best way of doing it.
Mm. Yeah. But the question on everybody's lips, especially the girls at home, will take that perform at the concert?
Do you know what? Nothing's been decided
yet. It's a yes or a no, Gary.
Nothing's been decided yet, but over the next couple of months, we're releasing more acts we're adding to the bill, so we'll have to wait and see.
Okay,
watch
good.
This space.
Mm-hmm. So you mentioned three sirs are going to be performing as well. Obviously, they're going to be fighting for dressing rooms in this place, aren't they? And Dan was saying with the 53 guest rooms.
I know it's going to be difficult because I'm getting the biggest.
Good, but of course there's no rush at all. I know we keep saying this, but there is no rush, is there, to get those tickets?
I would say on the contrary, I think you might forget. So get it online right now, booking your tickets.
Okay, but 2nd of March is the key date.
Yep. I think we've got up till midnight on the 2nd of March. Yeah. But, you know, that's not a lot of tickets to go round also. So if I was you, I'd get on the internet right now or write in.
After the show.
Keep watching until then.
Yeah, there's a nice little dance coming up shortly. People won't want to see them. But anyway, the ballot is open for this spectacular concert. 5,000 pairs of tickets are available. Applicants must be 18 years or over from today. Go to bbc.co.uk/diamondjubilee to apply.
Or you can enter by post. Send your full name, address, contact number and confirmation that you are over 18 to Gary.
The Diamond Jubilee Concert 2012, P.O. Box 798, Manchester M60 1WU. Do people really still use the post?
Oh, yes, yes, absolutely. If it wasn't for the post, Rickshaw Challenge, well, all them cheques coming in.
Okay. Oh, that's right.
In that case, they do.
Yeah, they do indeed. Anyway, successful applicants will be able to take a guest who must be aged 13 or over from today.
Yes, only one application per person. You must have a residential address here in the UK. For full terms and conditions, go to the website.
Now, as well as getting to see performances from the likes of Shirley Bassey, Paul McCartney and Jessie J, lucky ticket holders will also be invited into the gardens here at Buckingham Palace for a special picnic before the concert.
Sounds lovely, doesn't it?
Yeah, sounds great.
Yes. Now, of course, every year Her Majesty hosts garden parties for invited guests from all over the country. Christine Walkden has been to meet a few of you who've been to tea with the Queen.
I just love a good rummage around a celebrity garden. And let's face it, they don't come much more famous than this one. And what a treat! I've got an invitation to go and look at the gardens at Buckingham Palace. Oh, crikey. It's big. The garden was first laid out by James I in 1609 as a mulberry plantation to grow silkworms. Over the course of 250 years, it was enlarged and sculptured into 40 acres, or 170,000 square metres, of beautiful parkland. Now, this is quite special. Daphne boa, spicy, rich fragrance. The acorn of this tree was sown on the day that Prince Charles was born. Since Elizabeth II came to the throne 60 years ago, over a million people from all walks of life have received a personal invite from the Queen to take tea with her on her back lawn. The tradition began in 1868 when Queen Victoria wanted to meet more of her subjects. They also acted as a way of introducing young debutantes to high society. In the 1950s, they became a way of rewarding acts of public service. Today, around 8,000 people attend each of the garden parties held in June and July each year. I wonder what it's really like going to the palace and meeting the Queen. The people gathered here have done just that. Wendy Sincock, Susan Ward and her husband Charles and Jenny Dabbs all attended garden parties at Buckingham Palace. Wendy was invited for her work with transplant charities, Jenny came with women's group The Corona Society, and Susan represented arts organisation The Overseas League.
Mum was at my house when the first invitation came from the Lord Chamberlain, and I said, oh, because there's obviously the seal on the envelope, and so straight away, after the excitement of jumping up and down and running around like a headless chicken, I typed back and put, any day would suit me.
I thought, panic, I've got nothing to wear.
Names for garden party invites are put forward by government, armed services and different charities and societies.
You go in through Buckingham Palace and everybody tends to rush through.
Right.
And I just wanted to take my time and have a good look around because I'd never actually been to the palace. The food looked fantastic, pristine and tiny and decorative.
They had quite a few small cakes.
And they had a little cucumber sandwich and a cup of tea.
At 4 p.m, the band strikes up with the national anthem, which gives the Queen a cue to appear on the steps of the palace.
We were standing quite far away at that point, and you were trying to look over people's heads. Are they coming? Are they coming? Can you see them?
All the goosebumps came. I mean, they were already there, but they came even more.
Yes. And the Lord Chamberlain's aides were looking for people that were in groups of four.
Right.
And Christine, who one of the ladies, piped up and she said, well, we're three, you know. And he said, oh, that'll do. And led us towards the Queen, and There we were.
Fantastic. I was drawing up lucky because I was asked who I'd like to meet.
Really?
Oh,
really?
I thought it was an extraordinary way of putting it. And I said, who have you got?
That's quite
it's not the most tactful thing to say. Yeah. And so they went through the list and I said, oh, no, I'll have the Queen. Please.
And here is the big moment for Charles and Susan.
I didn't actually remember what I talked to the Queen about. Mm. Susan reminded me afterwards. I was about to launch into a deep analysis of the railway timetable.
An honour to cherish, actually. One of those surreal moments that you would never expect, and then she was just beautiful. The whole day was beautiful.
Garden parties clearly leave a real impression on those who've been, and for me, and I think the palace, they're a great way for the Queen to meet a few more of her subjects who have helped society.
I just wonder what the head gardener really thinks about all those people tramping over his lovely lawn.
That's a good question.
Yes. Yeah. Well, the closest thing we have to royalty on the one ship, well, apart from Dan Snow, of course, is Giles Brandreth.
Yes.
And you're joining us in the palace. Nice to see you, Giles.
I'm excited to be here, honoured to be here. A bit alarmed to be back in this room, though. The last time I was in this room, about a year ago, at a charity event hosted by the Duke of Edinburgh, I was making my speech and Prince Philip barracked me continually. Kept saying, oh, we've heard that story before. Some new material, please. Oh, do shut up. Oh, doesn't he go on? Doesn't he? Eventually, I sort of ground to a halt.
He was a heckler.
He was a royal heckler. He's a remarkable person. They are a remarkable double act, you know.
Yeah.
He may have undermined me, but I have to tell you, the support he's given the Queen these past 60 years is extraordinary. When I was writing a book about them about 10 years ago, I went to the Royal Variety Show with them. Mm-hmm. And during the interval, the Queen came out, and of course, the Queen is immediately surrounded by people. And I stood in a corner of this crowded room. And across the crowded room, the Queen, who's quite small, standing in this circle of show business people, the Duke of Edinburgh, holding a glass in his hand, leaning against the wall, caught her eye. And he simply lifted his glass and smiled at her. And she smiled.
That's a lovely story, isn't it?
And the curious thing is, nobody is normal with the Queen, you know, except for the Duke of Edinburgh. And nobody can say to the Duke of Edinburgh, oh, Philip, do shut up, except for the Queen. And she does.
Good for her.
It's worth remembering, here we are, this palace where they now live. They didn't want to live here. 1952, when the Queen became Queen, they were living down the Mall in Clarence House, and they wanted to stay there. It was a family home. But Winston Churchill, Prime Minister at the time, said, no, this is the headquarters of the royal family. You move here. And the reason they wanted to stay as a family is for the first 5 years of their marriage, from 1947 to 1952, they were almost an ordinary naval couple, stationed in Malta, where, you know, Prince Philip was a naval officer. The Queen was almost like a normal naval wife. She went to the local beauty salon. She drove Prince Philip's MG around the island. Once had a little encounter with a fellow on a donkey who would not move. You know, a short, narrow path, the Queen in her MG, the fellow on the donkey, and I'm afraid, you know, these Maltese, well, he was across Maltese, he did not, I mean, he stood his ground, and the Queen, well, he didn't know she was going to be the Queen, and so there, she's a, what is interesting about the Queen is she's driven by duty, sustained by faith. But she's actually, of course, a normal human being.
And for anybody who saw the documentary last night, I mean, her energy is incredible. She never stops all these engagements worldwide, you know. But when she does get spare time, how does she relax?
387 engagements last year. This is a woman in her mid-80s. On she goes. She watches the telly.
See, your rickshaw challenge is nothing compared to...
She watches the telly.
She watches the telly, listens to the radio, does the odd crossword puzzles, been known to play a game of Scrabble. She enjoys music of a light and popular kind, particularly from her generation. For example, she does a very good impression of George Formby. I have to tell you, if you did, when I'm cleaning windows at your concert, I promise you the Queen could join in, because I know, as a matter of fact, that she can do an impression of George Formby. I don't know if she plays the ukulele, but she can sing when I'm cleaning windows.
Well, we were thinking of opening with that, actually.
There you are.
Yeah.
Has the Queen specified, then, the type of music she'd like to hear at the concert?
We've had a few requests from the princes about the type of artist they'd like. The Queen has specified she would like to focus on the Commonwealth, artists from the Commonwealth, although we are having artists from global artists from all over the world. But you know, what we're trying to do on this concert is give every decade of her reign a chance to be heard musically. So we'll be doing music from 50s, 60s, right the way through to now.
OK, and what would you say that her standout moment would
be? Well, 60 years, all of those decades? What I think is extraordinary about the Queen is she's delivered the goods in the same way for 60 years.
Yeah.
Calmly. She never gets hurried, she never gets flustered. It's the same consistent Queen. Not a celebrity, she is just Queen. The same person with a crowd of a million as she is, as Prince Philip once said to me, with one person. You won't notice a difference with her. But if I chose a standout moment, I'll pick one. A recent one, mid-80s, here she is, this woman. Last year she went to Ireland. She went to the Republic of Ireland, you know, independent Ireland, where, you know, one of her, actually a member of her own family had been killed by the IRA, and yet she went there, she turned up, delivered the goods, looked the part, and actually had learnt some words of Gaelic. No wonder the President of Ireland, when she heard her, went, wow, wow.
Absolutely. Well, I tell you what, it goes without saying that it's wonderful that the One Show can be here live from Buckingham Palace.
Yes, it is. And that wasn't the only privilege we were given, was it, Matt?
No, let's just say it was a day that we will never, ever forget.
Music and dance have always played an important role in life at Buckingham Palace.
From grand occasions to private performances from musical genius, such as Mozart, who played for George III and Queen Charlotte in 1764.
And to events held here in the largest room in the palace, the ballroom. Opened in 1856 by Queen Victoria with a celebratory ball to mark the end of the Crimean War, it has hosted countless occasions since.
At the invitation of Queen Victoria, some of the world's greatest musical talents, such as Mendelssohn and the orchestra of Johann Strauss II, have passed through the palace gates.
But years later, another future queen helped bring music and dance to the palace. Contrast the formality of palace piano lessons for the young princess.
With the joy of witnessing crowds celebrating the end of the war with popular songs that can have rarely been heard inside.
Roll out the barrel, we'll have a barrel of fun.
4 years later, and a rare glimpse of Elizabeth, now married but not yet crowned, dancing with Prince Philip in Malta.
That was a very public event, but there is a piece of music that is said to be a private and personal favourite of the couple. Inspired by a visit to see the musical Oklahoma in 1947, the year they were married.
It's called People Will Say We're In Love.
People will say we're in love.
It was the song that the couple danced to at a ball held here at Buckingham Palace just 3 days before they were married.
And almost 65 years later, Matt and I have the honour of performing our own dance in the palace to this very special song. Headliners.
Amazing.
For your Diamond Jubilee concert.
Do you know what? Like Torval and Dean without the ice skates. Amazing.
Now, seriously, Gary, if you want to, we'll do that on the roof.
I'll keep it in mind.
Good luck.
Yeah.
Well, listen, that's all we've got time for tonight.
Yes, if you want to enter the ballot for tickets to the Diamond Jubilee concert on June the 4th, go to bbc.co.uk/diamondjubilee to apply. And remember, there is no need to rush, or there might be, as Gary said.
Well, it really doesn't matter if you apply today or any time before the 2nd of March when the ballot closes, because tickets are not on a first-come, first-served basis.
Yes, for full terms and conditions, please go to bbc.co.uk/diamondjubilee.
Well, Gary, thanks ever so much for joining us.
Welcome.
It will soon be Sir Gary, sure of it. Thanks to Her Majesty the Queen for having us.
Yes, we'll have to have her back for tea sometime soon.
I think we should. Normal service resumes tomorrow morning.
Have a lovely evening. Bye-bye.